Thank you very much for this introduction and for giving me the opportunity to talk here to you about human milk oligosaccharides, something that fascinates many researchers that I know, and me, myself included, since quite some time. So my disclosure, I'm working at the Nestle Research Center in Lausanne, near here, near Geneva. I thought I'd start with a little outline, so first give you some context in the context of which we should consider the HMOs. And then I will come from, show you some results on HMO research, how we approach this from observation trials to come to causality. And I have two examples mainly. One is on growth and development, and one on immune competence that includes allergies and infection. And then I have a short conclusion and outlook. And then we will come to the clinical trials that Philippe will present. So before starting, I think it's always interesting to see what are the different benefits that we can have actually from breastfeeding and what are the strengths of breastfeeding. And here it's, I think, a consensus still in the literature in developed and in developing world that in terms of infection risk reduction, there is a big benefit with breastfeeding. Then when it comes to obesity, diabetes, metabolic aspects of growth of an infant, it's a bit more debated and it's a bit less clear, but still there is quite a good consensus that there is some benefit of breast milk compared to alternative feeding. And then when it comes to allergies, the situation gets more complicated. And I think you all know that there is a multifactorial influence. And this means probably we have to dissect apart very many factors to better understand where is actually the risks and where are the opportunities to help infants who are at risk to get allergies. And of course, all these benefits that are linked to breastfeeding and breast milk suggest that there might be a specific ingredient in breast milk that is actually responsible, or at least in part responsible for the benefits. Now, a second aspect I think that we need to consider when we consider the infant nutrition in early life is that they are also getting now the microbiome from the mother and the environment, and this microbiome establishes during the first, let's say, couple of years of life. I show you on the one side here, sorry if this works, so on this side here, I show you a figure that we reanalyzed, actually a publication from Droger et al. From a Singapore cohort, where we looked at fecal community types, and you can see the fecal community types are actually designated in the different colors, and they're dominated by different bacterial groups. So for example, the light blue early in life is dominated by Enterobacteriaceae as a family. And then you come to other dominants, for example, the bifidobacteria dominance here in the blue group, with about 80% dominance, and then the red group with about 92% dominance. So these establish with time. And when you see a link between the different time points by green, that means there's a progression from one community type to the next. So this shows that indeed early life microbiome establishes in a way stepwise with different community types that are in the baby with different dominance of bacteria. And this is also summarized here in a way that you come away from inter-individual variability to more bacterial diversity with development. So this is important to keep in mind. And when we look more in detail, what does it mean for life and for clinical aspects? I modified here a slide from Blanton et al., where you can see the seeding part from the mother to the infant, and then you have a normal pass on microbiota maturation with age. But you can have different perturbations into this pass. So these are our risk factors here. So C-section births is one, preterm birth is another very important one, antibiotic use, and especially recurrent or repeated antibiotic use is a very important factor, or short and no breastfeeding is another risk factor that could play into the microbiome and the perturbation of normal development and normal immune physiological development. And then, of course, you know, we all know that actually these risk factors are associated to different problems that can be seen in the infant. So now the question is, of course, what are those breast milk specific components that help in early life to have a maturation of the early life microbiome in the right way to have this immune education and competence developed. Now for that, we want to see first, you know, how is the gross composition of breast milk? So if you look at this figure here, you can see, of course, water is the main component. And then in the solid part, you have the macro micronutrients. And as one big component, you have human milk oligosaccharides. So these are a bit 5 to 15 grams per liter. This depends on the lactation time. And it depends on the depths of analysis that we can have on the molecules. But what we can do is now about 23 HMOs that we can quantify with validated methods. And what we see here is actually a compilation from literature. What are the main dominant HMOs? So just with a pie chart, and you can see that of all the 130 structures that are described, probably about 15 make up over 80% of the bulk. And then another important aspect when we talk about alternative feeding to breast milk is that most of these HMOs are actually not present in farmed animal milks. So alternative food usually does not have these components. Now I want to show you just very quickly how are these HMOs made. I think this is important for an aspect that we discuss in the next slide then. So they're all made by glycosyl transferases, like fucosyl transferases, CLIL transferases, galactosyl transferases, and so on. And they elongate basically lactose here that can be elongated with these different monosaccharides. I would say the most interesting ones are fucose and sialic acid, because these are the endpoints on the HMOs that are produced. And these are usually the more important parts when you talk about glycobiology and the interaction with microbes or even with host cell receptors. And then you have alternative prebiotics. So one is made also of lactose, but it's elongated only by galactose here. And you can have different type of linkages. And then there is an alternative prebiotic also here made of table sugar sucrose. And these are the so-called FOS or inulin. So these are just linear chains usually of fructose molecules on sucrose. So this is very different from what we have with HMOs. Now, if we think about the HMOs and we look at, for example, a profile of HMO shown here with an HPLC separation, you can see the different molecules. And this is typical what you would see. The majority are relatively small molecules, and they are decorated, as I said, with sucrose and sialic acid. Now, if we look at the mucosal surface, you know, you have here staining of sialic acid or fucose in red on a small intestine section or a large intestine section. And when you look at those glycans, you can easily see that these all represent very similar or identical structures to HMOs. So that, I think, makes them extremely interesting, because now we have something that is at the interface between our microbiome and all the interaction with the environment and the intestine. And these molecules are exactly the same as in breast milk. So when we come to HMO biology, I think another little context. So HMOs are usually not digested by the small intestinal enzymes or lactases in the mouse already. And small amounts are absorbed or excreted then in urine. So this is about 1 to 2% that might go systemic. And some HMOs are differentially fermented. So there are reports where almost no HMO is actually fermented, and in some infants you have some individual HMO fermented, and in others you might have a lot more of different ones that are fermented or disappearing. So the big question is, of course, what would they do? And I depict here a scheme that will come up later again, and this is basically our thinking pad on how are the different modes of action, how HMOs could interact with the epithelial surface and with the developing microbiome. Now, in sake of time, I move on. So how do we actually study the HMO functions? I think, personally, it's very important to start from clinical observation, because then we don't just see a function, but we see that there is a clinical relevance, and that gives us a hypothesis on what we should actually study in a mode of action model. So we start usually on this side here with clinical observation. What are the benefits that can be associated to HMO composition? And then we come back and ask, you know, what could be the mechanism on this? And eventually, you will see later from Philip's talk, we need basically randomized controlled trials to really establish causality. Now, if I give you here an example that refers to a talk of my colleague Aristea Binia tomorrow morning at around 8 o'clock in one of the rooms, where we look also at maternal parameters that could actually influence the HMO composition. And I think this is very important to dissect apart these different confounding factors that might impact any association that we see. And what we clearly see is genotype and lactation stage are the most important ones that change composition of HMO. And then on the infant side, we focus mainly on growth development, and we will include here also like body composition in the future. We also started to look at allergies and infectious morbidity as actually the benefits that are mostly associated with breastfeeding. Now, if we just have a quick look at the HMO composition in different mothers, I told you that the fucosyl transferase and mainly here the secretor gene, fucosyl transferase 2, and the Lewis gene, fucosyl transferase 3, are the ones responsible and well described to make actually different fucosylated HMO. So we can actually have four groups, four milk groups that are depicted here, negative, 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 positive, positive, negative, positive, positive. And you can see here how the different HMOs actually vary between the groups and how the total amount varies. And you can see here with time of lactation how these actually HMO vary with time. So some are extremely high when you don't have fucosylation. This is not surprising because this is one of the major acceptor substrates for the HMO. So I show you this figure because I think when we try to learn from observation trials, we need to keep in mind how things change with time of lactation so that we don't compare early time to late time because that could confound. And we need to take into account the genotype of the mother that determines then these type of milk types. And we need to take into account, obviously, the infant genotype also because that will also be a confounder. So now let's come to the first, back to our biology slide on the first aspect here. Do HMOs affect human microbiome? So I think during this conference you will have a lot of talks about microbiome in early life, and you will have a lot of talks maybe from other people also on the role of HMO in early life microbiome. So I thought I summarize it here into a very simple view. So first, from observations, we know that Bifidobacteria dominance is in some cases associated to 2' fucosyl lactose or 2' fucosylated HMO based on the secretor gene. And these are different studies that show that. We don't see that necessarily in all geographies, so there might be redundancy in some places that you have other Bifidobacteria that can also use other HMOs and you wouldn't necessarily see this association. Then the basic research studies actually identify different bifidobacteria strains, even within the same species, that can use or not HMO and have different metabolic activation. And this metabolic activation is actually what I wanted to show you here as an example, because we have actually very strain-specific and also HMO-specific metabolic stimulation, not only of growth, but of metabolic activity of the bacteria. And then we can ask the question, so what that stimulation does. And we have here two models. One is an inflammatory signaling upon Salmonella stimulation, where we see that a medium that was conditioned with a bifidobacteria fermented with different HMOs has different anti-inflammatory properties. And then when we look at Salmonella invasion, for example, here we see also a strong reduction then with that medium that was fermented with 2FL and Bifinfantis. So I think we should start to look at the microbiome, not only in terms of composition, but really in terms of function. Now let's very quickly come to growth and development. So here is a bit less to say. Is there any change that we can observe in observation trials? We did one study in a Singapore cohort with 25 boys and 25 girls, where we compared actually, here just those mothers who have an infant, those mothers with high amounts of 2FL and their infant growth, or those mothers with the non-secretor genotype that have actually almost no 2FL. We called it here low because there is still something that can be measured, but it's basically nothing. And you can see a big gap actually between the two groups. So we compare this group of infant's fat from this milk to infant's fat this milk. And we have 50 infants here, 25 boys and 25 girls. We looked at body weight, body length, head circumference, and body mass index calculated. And maybe not surprising, we see actually absolutely no indication that we would have a change in growth parameters in the first 4 months of life. So the very severe change, let's say, in the HMO composition in this cohort did not translate into a change in growth parameters. Another group here studied a smaller group of infants, of 25 infants, and they associated actually with body fat mass, but also with lean and general growth parameters, one of the fucosyltransferase 2 dependent HMOs, LNFP1, which is shown here. They associated to lower fat mass when you have higher amounts of LNFP1 in the breast milk. And this is at 6 months of age. And then they have a FUD3 dependent, so basically the opposite way, if you want, in the two fucosyltransferases, that goes the other way around. So this is a first indication that maybe there is something. We don't know. I would consider very preliminary for the moment. And definitely, I think we need longer follow-up and we need to include more body composition data. Now let's come to allergies, so immune competence-related aspects. Do we see any changes here in cohort studies? So here, together with Erkki Savilahti and the team that you see, and Clemens Kunz, who is in the audience, we did a study with a Helsinki cohort. So this was the placebo group of the Flora intervention study that started in around 2000. And again, we grouped actually the infants into those who did not get 2' fucosylated HMOs, so the non-secretor milk type, compared to those who got 2' fucosylated HMOs in breast milk. And we looked at allergies up to 5 years of age in general or IgE-related, and also sensitization. So as I said, from this Flora study, we used the placebo group for this trial. And we had actually samples of 266 mothers to use in this trial. Now, what did we find? So when we just look globally, and you concentrate here on this figure, you see that at 2 years of age, we see a certain prevalence of the allergic onset. So they were all with a hereditary risk for allergy. And then at 5 years, this further increases. But when you look at the C-section-born infants who get a FUD2 negative milk, so the non-secretor milk, they seem to be already much higher at 2 years and similar to the 5-year time point here. So that was an indication that maybe something happens. So if we looked a bit more in detail in the statistical analysis with a logistic regression model, we see that maybe there is a trend to a beneficial effect of the FUD2 positive milk in the infants at risk for allergy who are C-section born, but not in the overall infant group. And when we analyze by amount of 2FL, then we get significant association that, again, here the ones with allergic disease had less 2FL in the breast milk early life. Now, this is a first indication. This is far from proof, but it gives us a hypothesis. And I like the hypothesis that we change something in the microbiome, because we know that C-section-born infants, at least to a certain period of time, they will have an altered microbiome in early life. Now, how does that affect really the observation that we see? So I show you here what Mikael Kuitunen had reported in another publication of the Flora study. So this is the placebo group prevalence of bifidobacteria over time. And you see the C-section-born infants up to 24 months seem to have lower prevalence of bifidobacteria. And then there is other circumstantial evidence here that Bifidobacterium breve, for example, is linked to reduced eczema risk in children at high risk of developing allergic disease, so a similar cohort than what we studied. And there is this study here from a Japanese group that specifically associated the 2' fucosylated HMO, like as an example 2FL, to specific B. breve strains and their metabolic activity in breastfed infants. So maybe that is a link that we can further establish now to see what happens in early life in a specific condition in terms of eczema risk. Now, another group again here, they looked at cow milk allergy. and they associated different individual HMOs that I circled with a circle red here, specifically here LNFP3 as the strongest. This remains significant even after adjustment for multiple comparison. And in general, I think you can see here that there are different types of HMOs. So you have 6-CLE lactose, you have di-CLE lactose that I showed you was very high, actually similar to this picture here in the FUT2 negatives, FUT3 negative breast milk. So maybe there's something particular with that genotype also. And then you have one that is FUT2 dependent, LNFP1. So they all showed a little bit of association. So the authors claim that maybe LNFP3 has an interaction, like other molecules with a similar structure here, with DC sign on dendritic cells in the mucosa. We don't know, and I think we can all agree that basically we need to know more and need to study more. So there is one animal trial that tried to understand more in a food allergy model, and basically what they found is that 2FL, so one FUT2-dependent HMO, and 6SL, similar to that previous study, that reduced the clinical score here in this food allergy model on diarrhea score and also on temperature loss. So maybe there is something happening, and we investigate that also with some mouse model on eczema to see whether these HMOs can help and what is the mechanism. So in the last 8 minutes or so, I try to rush a bit. 5 minutes, yeah, okay. And come to infections. So what do we know about infections and association studies, and how are they backed up with preclinical models? So these are the pioneering works, I think, of the Newberg group and then of other groups in Davis, where they associated here diarrhea in a Mexican cohort to the amount of 2' fucosylated HMO. And this was particularly for Campylobacter diarrhea, but also other types of diarrhea like norovirus diarrhea, where low amounts give you higher prevalence compared to high amounts of these fucosylated HMOs. And similar here, again, FUT2-dependent HMO seems to be associated also in an African cohort to less morbidity. Now, we also did a study here in Dhaka in the ICDDR, where we have a birth cohort of initially 267 infant mother pairs, and we genotyped, because we had at the end 220 infants in the study still, so we genotyped them to understand their breast milk type. So we genotyped for FUT2 positive negative and FUT3 positive negative, and these are actually very nice markers for the milk type. So this we did from another study, and some of you might have heard Aristea Binia talking about this yesterday. So these are good proxies for the milk type. And what we look at, what I show you today here, is acute respiratory infections up to 2 years, and we have other parameters that we currently investigate in this cohort where we have high prevalence of infections. Now, what did we find? So when we associate to the breast milk genotype, basically, we have actually found favoring the FUT2 positive breast milk in the breastfeeding period. So at 6 months, we had 78% still exclusively breastfed. At 4 months, we had 100% still exclusively breastfed. And this was the significant association here with acute respiratory infection. And then that disappears with time. So we don't see it later on. Infection risk actually goes down also later in time. We don't see any association in breast milk dependent on the FUT2 type. And when we look at the infant genotype, we also do not see the association that we might expect for some viruses, like norovirus, that gives more where FUT2 positive infants might be more susceptible compared to FUT2 negative. But not in this case for respiratory, but norovirus for the diarrhea. Now, how is this backed up with preclinical data? So there is, actually in the last 3 months, we have 2 minutes. So we have actually very good preclinical data that show us effects on Campylobacter jejuni, where we have 2' fucosylated HMO specifically that seem to block the adhesion of this Campylobacter causing the diarrhea. While for other type of bacteria that cause diarrhea, for example, E. coli here, the mechanism that is proposed that gives protection, again by 2' fucosyl lactose, was more an anti-inflammatory property. So there might be different ways how HMO interact with the host to then give this type of protection. And then there is also preclinical data on influenza and syncytial virus. And I show you here just some preliminary results from study that we did on influenza virus model, where we see in an experiment here, first experiment, reduction on the clinical score with the HMO that we give at 1 or 5%. And then we see that also in the weight loss, that we have less weight loss. This is the peak of the problem for the mouse with this influenza. And what we think is the mechanism behind is actually established here in a second experiment, where we see specific T cells that are specific for this influenza virus that seem to go up faster and more in the HMO groups compared to the control group. And they also seem to disappear faster again once we resolve the problem at 14 days. Now, I just made it in time to the conclusion. So I would say the question is, of course, very challenging. You know, why are they in mother's milk? I think it's very pretentious to have an answer. So I put possibly. And I think possibly because there is still data missing and there is still only circumstantial evidence. But I think they help the development of an appropriate immune system or immune competence. And I think also very likely part of this goes through the microbiome. And we can then say the HMO can be positioned maybe as a multifactorial component here. And the outlook, I think Philippe will start with the outlook. So I'll start with, that will be certainly more randomized controlled trials where we need to establish causality. But I think also we can still learn a lot from well-defined cohort studies when we take into account these different factors that some of them I mentioned, like genotype of infant and mother, time of lactation, and so on, to basically eliminate a maximum of confounders that might disturb and might give you a wrong hypothesis. And with that, I thank you very much for the attention, and I want to acknowledge my co-workers, Clemens Kunz, Erki, Anna, Karina, Michael, Shafiq, and Shamima from Dhaka, and then from National University of Singapore, Yele Li, and then from the research center, several people that you might hear in talks here, and of course, the study teams and participants in the studies. Thank you very much.
Thank you.